Hi, I'm Sue Hample, co-president of the Holocaust Centre. It is with absolute pleasure that I welcome Michael and his wife Melissa to Melbourne. They arrived from Los Angeles very early this morning, and Michael, I hope you're not too jet-lagged. Where do I start to tell you about our keynote speaker? If I told you about all the Holocaust articles, books, lectures, documentaries, films, organisations, and museums that Michael has been involved with, we would be here all evening. So here are just some of his career highlights. Dr. Michael Berenbaum is a writer, lecturer, and teacher who consults in the conceptual development of museums and historical films. He is currently director of the Siggy Zierling Institute, which was formerly the University of Judaism, where he is also a professor of Jewish studies. Prior to his association with the American Jewish University, Michael served as president of the Survivors of the Shoah Visual History Foundation, which actually brought him to Australia for the very first time in 1999. Michael was the director of the United States Research Institute at the US Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington. From 1988 until 1993, he served as project director of the museum and oversaw its creation. Michael has held the position of director of the Jewish Community Council of Greater Washington. He was the opinion page editor of the Washington Jewish Week, deputy director of the President's Commission on the Holocaust, where he authored the report to the President. Dr. Berenbaum was the conceptual developer on the Illinois Holocaust Museum that recently opened in Skokie, Chicago, the Dallas Holocaust and Human Rights Museum, as well as museums in Cincinnati and Brooklyn. Michael has consulted and or curated and developed museums across the globe, including Belzec in Poland, the Tolerance Museum in Mexico City, and he is currently working on the Memorial Museum of Macedonian Jewry. Now, that's not all. In his spare time, Michael was the author and editor of 22 books, scores of scholarly articles, hundreds of journalistic pieces, which have won him several awards. And over the past decade, he was historical consultant for dozens of Holocaust films, including Conspiracy, Uprising, and Defiance, and documentaries such as The Last Days and One Survivor Remembers, both of which won Academy Awards. Michael, we are so honoured that you have travelled all the way here to Australia to deliver tonight's keynote address at the annual Betty and Shmuel Rosenkranz Oration. We look forward to hearing your talk on shifting narratives of the Holocaust in contemporary society.
Thank you, Sue, for an overly kind introduction. I'm going to begin with a family story. The first award I ever received was something called the Silver Angel Award. And you have a problem when you visit when you get the Silver Angel Award, the problem is who can you tell? I had teenage kids. At that point, my kids thought I was the devil incarnate. My wife asked me to put the cap on the toothpaste and to make sure to lift the seat before I went to the men's room. So I did the only honorable thing a man can do, which is I called my mother. And my mother said, "I know you're an angel, now try being like a mensch." So whenever I get an introduction like that, I have to remember that my mother said, "Try being a mensch." Let me talk very seriously. This is the first opportunity I've had to, actually the second opportunity. No, believe it or not, it's the third opportunity I've now had to speak in the aftermath of what happened in Pittsburgh. And I think it's important to report to you before I speak about what I wanted to speak about, a little bit about what happened in Pittsburgh and what it means for the Jewish people. You're not going to be pleased because this is not something that's designed to please you. It's designed to inform you. A word about where we are in the United States, and this is in keeping with the old Yiddish phrase, before I begin to speak, let me say a few words. We have to understand that we're in a unique situation today, which is Jews are seen by others in a way that they do not see themselves. And that is, Jews are seen by others in the United States as a privileged part of the white majority. And Israel itself is seen in a way that it does not see itself. It's seen as a regional military superpower and as a modern economic miracle. Every Jew I know sees themselves as a minority, but it's the fact that we're a majority and a privileged part of the white majority that sets some of the boundaries with regard to anti-Semitism, and also the perception of Israel not as victim but as oppressor that sets another context for it as well. If you ask every Jew in the United States, or perhaps even in the world, is anti-Semitism on the increase, they will all raise their hands and say yes. If you look at the empirical evidence as to whether anti-Semitism is on the increase, and you ask the following questions: are greater percentages of the population anti-Semitic now than they were 20 years ago, 40 years ago, or 60 years ago? The answer is no. If you even look, ADL has done a longitudinal study of anti-Semitism in the United States. And their problem is that some of the methodology that they use for a longitudinal study, asking the same questions for 50 and 60 years, sounds very differently in 2016 when they did the study than it did in 1956 or 66 or 76. Example. If you ask, do Jews have undue influence in the American economy? In 2016, you were dealing with the chairman of the Federal Reserve was Jewish, the vice chairman of the Federal Reserve was an Israeli, the head of the Council of Economic Advisors was Jewish, and the Secretary of Treasury was not only Jewish, but an Orthodox Jew to boot. The predecessor of the Federal Reserve was a man by the name of Shalom Ben Bernanke, and his vice chairman was also Jewish, and their predecessors were also Jewish. And you have to ask yourself the question, and now the heads of the major banks in the United States are all Jewish because the glass ceiling has ended. So you have to ask yourself the question, is saying Jews have undue influence in the American economy an anti-Semitic statement or a factual statement? And you have to understand that very well. There was a great student of anti-Semitism in America by the name of Earl Rabb who said that the reason there is this disconnect between the perception of Jews, the reality of Jews perceiving anti-Semitism is on the rise, is because the expression and the permissibility of the expression of hatred is now on the increase, and the restraint on the expression of hatred is on the decrease. If you hated 30 years ago, it was impolite to make a racist statement or most especially an anti-Semitic statement, precisely because the Holocaust had provided a certain sense of disdain for anti-Semitism in general. But the reality is that we now have no restraint on the expression of hatred. And in the United States, you not only have that, but you have a combination of three other factors. One is polarization itself. The second is amplification of hatred by the internet and the community of hatred that is created by social media. And then we have a new phenomenon, which is the expressions of code words by the president are regarded as license by an extreme element in the United States to express hatred in a variety of ways. The bizarre news for Jews is we are not the primary target. There are four or five groups ahead of us, but that doesn't mean we are not a target. Let me talk for a moment about good news from Pittsburgh. The first comes from the idea that in the United States we have a concept of hate crime. And hate crime is very important because when you speak of hate crime, it is an attack on the society in total. And because you regard it as an attack on the society in total, it allows those who are opposed to hate to come together. So what's the good news of Pittsburgh? The good news of Pittsburgh is that civil society held together. The mayor was there immediately saying, this does not represent Pittsburgh. We don't want haters among us. District attorney said, we will use all the instrumentalities of law to bring this person, to the perpetrator, to justice. The police went in to save the Jews. They paid for it with their life. That's radically different, for example, than Kristallnacht, than the Reichspogrom, in which the police stood by to, the firemen were instructed, don't put out the fire in the synagogue, just make sure the adjacent buildings don't catch fire. Explicit instructions given by telegram. So what were the only synagogues left standing in Germany? Were the synagogues what? That were part of larger complexes where you couldn't allow them to catch fire because homes and businesses by non-Jews would then catch fire. You also had the solidarity of the community. Imagine the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Pittsburgh Penguins put a Jewish star on their uniform before they played the next game. The World Series paused for a moment of silence for 11 Jews. 100 members of the Pittsburgh Steelers, including the owners and the coach, came to the funeral of the first two Jews who were to be buried because their sister had once been part of the team. She had been part of community outreach. So what you had there was you had essentially, and the most important, absolutely the most important thing that happened was that the Muslim community contributed not $125,000, but by now $250,000 toward the Tree of Life, the Eitz Chaim Synagogue in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, to help the people and to rebuild the synagogue. Now that says that we may be developing in the United States, if not a moderate Muslim community, then a Muslim community that has learned the rules of participation in American life. And the rules of participation in American life means that interreligious life, freedom of religion, is an absolute. From 1790 onward, George Washington wrote a letter to the Newport congregation. He said, happily, the government of the United States gives to bigotry no sanction, to persecution no assistance. And that has been the standard, and interreligious life means, in essence, that religious life has to be protected, and synagogues were respected as a house of God. That, and by the way, they were respected by the house of God, but some of the polarization in the Jewish community itself had that a little bit questioned. We had a particular problem. Our president is incapable of bringing the community together with words. Similar circumstances, you had Ronald Reagan, and I'm being bipartisan, who was able to bring the community together after the Challenger disaster. George W. Bush, who was able to bring the community together after 9/11, and who was able to go to a Muslim mosque and speak of religious tolerance as the essence of America. Bill Clinton, who was able to speak after the attack in Oklahoma City in April 19th. April 19th, ironically, was the day before Hitler's birthday, and it had a link to the fascination with the ultra-right, with Nazism, and Barack Obama, who was able to do it again and again and again, because we have a terrible problem of gun violence in the United States. And he did it with Sandy Hook when they murdered children. He did it in Charlotte when they entered a black church. And only 2 days before the attack in Pittsburgh, a man murdered in Kentucky murdered two African Americans in a parking lot because somehow he felt his entry into a black church was barred. We live in a world, and we in America are pained by it, grieved by it, ashamed of it. We live in a world in which if you feel hatred, you feel empowered to express that hatred, and you don't feel the disrespect when you express that hatred. And that means essentially that those of us who are against hatred, who are on the side of what? We're on the side of the people who want civility, decency, pluralism, and tolerance, and infinite respect for the humanity of all of God's creation, have to come together to oppose that. That's the report we have. That's what makes our work in Holocaust education so important. And that's why what Jane said is all important. You've given me a beautiful introduction. I've created institutions that have drawn together in excess of 100 million people. Holocaust Museum itself has drawn 50 million visitors in the 26, 27 years that it's been in existence. My dream is that we should be irrelevant. That somebody should visit a Holocaust museum and say, look how idiotic 20th century people were. We couldn't do something like this. But we used to say never again, and now we have to grapple with the problem of we're not irrelevant, we are frighteningly relevant. And when we deal, for example, with opposition to Kristallnacht, in America, the opposition to the Reichspogrom of 1938 was 97%. The willingness to take refugees in the aftermath of that increased by 3%. We hate what they're doing, but we don't want them here. Problem of immigration, they're going to take American jobs. We have proof of it. The aftermath of Kristallnacht. England accepted 10,000 Jewish children. Now I want you to think of this for a moment. What would it take for a parent to give away their child, to send them into the arms of strangers? What it took was knowing that A, you loved your child, but you could not protect your child. And the situation was going to get so bad that you had to give your child away in order to save their life. For most of us, imagining that breaks our heart. It's almost inconceivable. an effort to bring 20,000 Jewish children to the United States in something called the Wagner-Rogers Bill, didn't even get out of committees on Congress. Those children would grow up, we were told, and take American jobs, and we have a sense of deja vu all over again. So those of us who are involved in Holocaust education want to dream of a day when we are irrelevant, when anti-Semitism is not the longest hatred, but a hatred that was long and resolved. And by the way, if you think of it, we have incredible moments. Imagine if somebody had told you, I was with a bishop of the Roman Catholic Church who said the following: the first time in 1987 that the bishop of Rome went to a synagogue in 1987 years since Jesus was in 1987. He said, since then, every bishop of Rome, meaning every pope, has gone to a synagogue, and every pope will hear too. Go to a synagogue. Why? Because the Roman Catholic Church faced its past and at least on this issue transformed its teaching. Okay, so much for the precursor, but no American can speak to an audience as informed and as serious as you are without touching on these issues today. Let me now talk a little bit about the changing narrative. Three initial points. The first is we all know that we are in a transitional moment. We are moving from living history to historical memory. We'll be blessed to have survivors with us for 5 more years, for 10 more years. We will not have survivors with us for 20 more years. And after survivors are gone, it is now the legacy of the people who have become the witnesses to the witnesses to presume that work and to assume that work. And consequently, we are at that moment, we are 1 minute to midnight and the clock is ticking. Two pieces of good news on that. The first is that we have an incredible collection now, more oral and visual history of survivors of the Holocaust than any event in human history. And we have probably about 80,000 different interviews that have been gathered. So we will be hearing from Holocaust survivors for generations. And think of its importance in the following way. In America, we only have 36 oral histories of people who were once slaves. But think what it would be like to sit at your table on Pesach and be able to hear of someone who was a slave in Egypt and who went forth to the Promised Land. Think what it would be like not to have a tradition that is a verbal tradition that has come down, or a written tradition that has come down, but to actually meet people who were there. And that's what we have for the future. But something major is going to be lost. The moral authority. The countervailing thing that imposes a tremendous responsibility on the institutions, which are now the heirs to memory. And the institutions have to welcome that, have to embrace that, and have to see themselves as responsible for that. And that's a tension that we have in every society, because we can't have the bureaucratization of memory. We have to have the embrace of it with all of its moral authority. Point one. Let's talk a little bit about where Holocaust scholarship is. Because the reality is that Holocaust scholarship is transforming the narrative as we think. Let's touch on several areas. There is a major Holocaust scholar, a major scholar of what we call the Badlands, which are Eastern European society, a fellow by the name of Timothy Snyder. Timothy Snyder has written a very important book called Black Earth. And what he wrote about essentially is he has a context for the Holocaust, and Timothy Snyder is a non-Jew, context for the Holocaust that sets Hitler's agenda. Hitler's agenda was twofold. Hitler's agenda was, number one, Lebensraum, living space, and secondly, it was a racial agenda to eliminate those who were in, to dominate those who were inferior, and to eliminate one group of people whom he regarded as a cancer on German society, and I use the word cancer deliberately and specifically, and they were the Jews. Snyder says, why did Hitler oppose, and Lebensraum essentially was to give Germany the context that Australia enjoys, that the United States enjoys. We speak of the United States as from sea to shining sea. In Australia, you have a vast land, a vast territory, and you can provide for yourself in an extraordinary way. We're at the 100th anniversary of World War I. World War I was essentially lost by Germany, not on the field of battle, but on the field of home, because it ran out of essentials. Rubber, gas, and a four-letter word. The first begins with an F, but the last are all important, F-O-O-D. And they were on the verge of starvation. Why did he want to conquer the East? Because he wanted the fertile lands, most specifically of the Ukraine. Why the Jews? Hitler lived in a world of total domination in which the powerful were to dominate, and if they were to compromise with the weak, they would be weakened. It was Darwin's survival of the fittest, and we nasty, vicious, miserable Jews taught two values that were antithetical to that survival and that were deliberately anti-Hitlerian. Anti-survival of the fittest, we taught, number one, compassion, and number two, justice. Domination cannot work with the notion of compassion, and domination cannot succeed with the notion of justice. So here is a non-Jew looking objectively at it who said that Hitler opposed the Jews precisely because he was opposing their worldview that introduced a concept into the world of compassion and justice. And he couldn't attack the Christians frontally, but he would have do that indirectly by going through the back door and attacking and eliminating the Jews, because domination cannot work if you have justice and compassion, and consequently anti-Semitism plays a major role. He taught something that is making all of Europe deeply uncomfortable. Let's go back for a moment. You've all been heard about the boogeyman of Holocaust denial. Holocaust denial essentially had two major attacks against Holocaust denial in the year 2000 and then in most recent years. The first is the defeat of David Irving, and I'm a friend of Deborah Lipstadt's, but I never speak of Deborah Lipstadt's triumph, I speak of David Irving's defeat. Not important that Deborah Lipstadt won, all important that David Irving lost. And Holocaust denial after David Irving lost. And why did David Irving lose? He lost essentially because of the fact that he was beat by his own research. Richard Evans investigated every footnote of everything that David Irving wrote. He went back to the original documents and he showed that David Irving misquoted the original documents. And when he did, he misinterpreted them to exonerate Hitler and to approve of the agenda. Robert Jan van Pelt essentially showed the nature of the pseudoscientific attack on Holocaust denial and showed the architecture of Auschwitz in all of its fullness. And in fact, this is where the movie denial misrepresented what had happened. And he showed the nature of the killing and the way in which it happened. And we have essentially resolved any of the academic issues that had been the undergirding of pseudo-scholarship of Holocaust denial. The second thing that happened is that let me explain it to you this way. The president of Iran, Ahmadinejad, was telling the president of Germany, you don't know German history, you didn't do anything. Think of the meshuga nature of the world in which we live in when the president of Germany says, we committed this, we have to face our past, and we have to do better in the future. And Ahmadinejad says to him, what did you commit? Who should know German history? The president of Germany, the chancellor of Germany. And in fact, Ahmadinejad didn't even know the history of his own people because Iran was a way station of rescuing Jews during the Shoah. And its record was one of nobility. And whenever I spoke about this, I kept saying, I can write a wonderful history of the decency of Iran, and he's trying to tell, in the wake of German atrocity, if I were trying to indict the West, I would say, look what you did as compared to what we did. But the reality is that with the combination of the defeat of David Irving and the passing of Ahmadinejad from the scene, Holocaust denial lost two of its noisiest makers. What is happening now is not Holocaust denial, but something much more different, which is a rewriting of the Holocaust. And we're going to see the clash between brilliant scholarship and right-wing governments that are trying to rewrite it. Jane mentioned the Polish government. And the Polish government made it first a criminal offense and then made it a civil offense, but deceivingly, and because the Israelis went along with it, which is absolutely tragic and foolish, deceivingly, they even took away the exception for artistic representation and for academic scholarship. And what can't you say? You can't say or speak ill of the Polish institutions. And you can't speak ill of the Polish government or the Polish people. And the reality is we now know much more about what happened in Poland, and the narrative itself has changed. Timothy Snyder comes along and he speaks about what he calls double occupation and double collaboration. Let me explain these two historical concepts to you. There were territories that were occupied first by the Soviet Union and after June 1941 by Germany. These territories included Eastern Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. And what Snyder has shown is that in the areas of double collaboration, of double occupation, there also was double collaboration. Groups that collaborated with the Soviet Union. And then in order to protect themselves, in order to cleanse themselves, collaborated with Nazi Germany and did the dirty work for Nazi Germany of killing its Jews. So in Estonia, no Jew was killed by a German. All Jews were killed by Estonians. In Lithuania, 2 out of 3 Jews were killed by Lithuanian nationalist groups. And only 1/3 had to be killed by Einsatzgruppen because the nationalist groups were promised what? They were promised that they might get independence if they collaborated with the Germans, and they did that by killing the Jews for them. In Latvia, the same type of phenomenon. And what do we have today? We have right-wing governments that want to reassert their own nationalism, and by doing so, they begin to deny their own history. And they deny their own participation in the murders, and they then put themselves in a very difficult situation because they, in essence, have to, as it were, revamp all that they're writing, and in certain countries, even rewrite their institutions. So in Lithuania, they are erecting statues to people who were guilty of murdering Jews. And in Hungary, and let's explain Hungary to you for 1 second. Hungary is the easiest of the evolution of the murder of the Jews to explain. March 19th, Hungary was invaded by Germany. In April and May, the Jews were ghettoized. Between the 15th of May and the 7th of July, 437,402 Jews were shipped on 147 trains to Auschwitz. And essentially, the killing, that meant that there were 2.7 trains a day with 2,975 Jews per train. And if you look at the railroad lines in Auschwitz itself, what happens? You have one railroad track that enters Auschwitz, enters Birkenau. It splits into three. That was installed in 1944. Why was it to split into three? Was to split into three because they understood that the only way to kill Hungarian Jews is if you could send three trains a day. Some of you have seen the March of the Living. Let me tell you what my first experience on the March of the Living was. When the March of the Living has Jews marching into Auschwitz, we have 12,000 Jews marching into Auschwitz on Yom HaShoah. And if you stand there, you have to look back. Vast, vast number of people. And I scratched my head and I said, that's the number of Jews who were killed every day during the summer of 1944. Astounding. Takes a Herculean effort of what? Of organization to kill these Jews. And it takes to bring these Jews to Auschwitz, to bring our students to Auschwitz, takes a Herculean organization, a global organization, and that was one day. Then Hungary, after July 7th, is a battle between the murderers and the rescuers, but then in the fall of 1944, the Hungarian Iron Guard takes hold and they start slaughtering the Jews for the Germans. And if you go to Hungary, you have the empty boots on the Danube River. And you know why you have the empty boots? Because these Hungarian murderers would gather the Jews, would rope them together, and would shoot every other one so that they would drown in the Danube, which turned red. And they didn't want to waste the bullets to kill everyone, so they only killed every other one. And now if you go into Hungary and you look at the institutions cannot tell that history, and therefore the Jewish community has to withdraw from that history. So the question of the narrative is the question between good scholarship, which is flourishing, and governmental efforts to rewrite their history. Let's talk about the things we couldn't talk about for a long time. There's a new book out, a couple of years old. The new book is on, it's called Holocaust Humor, It Kept Us Alive. You couldn't talk for a very long time about how Jews grappled with their own situation. One of the ways Jews grappled with their own situation was something that you couldn't talk about called humor. And I have to tell you that I've been collecting Holocaust humor for about 30 years, ever since I found myself laughing when I was reading a memoir, when I was reading actually a diary. And I said, I'm not the worst person in the world. I study the worst person in the world. So if I'm laughing, there must be something there. And I realized that Chaim Kaplan used humor in order to get you to be able to read, in order for himself to read it. So a woman wrote about the way in which Jews used humor. Let me tell you four Holocaust jokes, but they're not funny. They are deeply funny, but they're not funny. Because humor is a way in which you can grapple with oppression. Four Jews are standing on a street corner. One says, oi. The other says, oi, oi. Third says, oi, veizmir. Fourth guy says, if we're going to talk politics all day, I'm leaving. Right? It's true. It's funny. A second example. Two Jews are reading two different newspapers. One is reading a newspaper and crying, the other is reading a newspaper and laughing. One guy looks over at the other and says, realizes the guy's laughing, he says, how can you read that garbage? He's reading Der Stürmer. And he's shocked by the reaction. The guy turns to him and says, how can you read that garbage? He's reading the Jewish newspaper. He says, can you ask me, how can I read that? He says, look, you read the Jewish newspaper, you see the situation is terrible, it's getting worse, it's miserable, it's horrible. I read Der Stürmer, I realize that Roosevelt is not Roosevelt, he's Rosenfeld, that we have all of this power, that we control the world. Why would I read your newspaper when I can read my newspaper? And part of that is to, again, grapple with it. The third is my favorite, which is a young boy's asked in the Warsaw Ghetto, what would you like most of all if you were Hitler's son? And the Yiddish is more beautiful, Ich will sein ein Yosem. I'd like to be an orphan. And I give you an hour, and you can if you can think of a better answer, I don't know of a better one. Humor was one of the ways in which they grappled with this situation. There were clowns in the Warsaw Ghetto. There were people who began to use satire as a modality. And remember, you have to grapple with that in a very particular way. The second taboo that has gone over now is a transformation, most especially in women's studies, in which they are talking about the paradox of the multiple paradox of sexuality. Women's studies have gone in a couple of directions over the years. The first generation tried to prove some feminist theory by virtue of teaching the Holocaust. And the second generation tries to use feminist theory in order to understand the Holocaust better. And the scholarship of the younger women is now extraordinary. But they're grappling with the combination of sexual exploitation that took place, oftentimes that took place both on the part of the Nazis, who faced a taboo if they had relations with Jewish women, in particular because they were violating the rules that were established at Nuremberg. But if they had relations, there was all sorts of sexual exploitation. But we've also seen something else. We've also seen the counter testimony of deep love that has developed because of the people who had only today and not tomorrow. And when you all have only today and not tomorrow, some bonds were established that were enormously intense. And where the two survived, it lasted a lifetime. Let me tell one story so you'll get an illustration of that. It's a story that I've heard directly from a survivor. A man by the name of Ben and Vladimir, they saw each other. How did they become boyfriend and girlfriend? It's a wonderful story. Vladka was working for the underground and she was going to be sent on a mission. She said to the boy that she had an interest in, the man, young man he had an interest in, she said, I'm going somewhere. My mother is dead. My father is dead. My brother is dead. Nobody cares for me. I'm going somewhere I'm not sure I can return. If I don't return, I want you to miss me. You can be my boyfriend. Think of that bond. They later are boyfriend, girlfriend. Ben comes from a very religious family. His mother sees that he's staying out all night. She takes off her wedding ring. She says, give it to Vladka, whose name was Feigl at that point, her nom de guerre was Vladka, and put it on her ringer, on her ring, finger, lifts up a cup and says, Zoltan mit Mazel. They later were married by a rabbi, but they felt that that was what? That was the marriage. So we learn on the one hand of sexual exploitation, the other is we learn of the intense sense of what's involved at that point. We also have another area of scholarship that has been developed, which is a whole range of religious decisions that have come out, which you look at either from both a religious perspective or from the perspective of what do we learn about history. Let's take a very simple example. You had a rabbi in the ghetto of Kovno by the name of Rabbi Ephraim Oshri. He's asked a question. Do you put a mezuzah on your door if you're in the ghetto? Jewish law is very clear on that. I'm staying in a room. If I stay in a room or in a house for less than 30 days, I have no obligation to put a mezuzah on my door. But if the house is going to be a permanent dwelling place of 30 days or more, then you have an obligation to put a mezuzah on the door. Halacha is clear, but the question, how do you answer the question, and what does that tell to your people in the ghetto? Do you want to tell them the ghetto is permanent? They may not take preparations to deal with the life in the ghetto. Or do you really want to tell them the situation is temporary and add to their anxiety, but also signal to them that this is a phase of something but not a permanent reality? So the rabbi didn't have to answer the halakhic question. He had to answer the more difficult question, which is the question of what situation are you living in? And the answer to that changed over a very particular time. Clear? In the same way that the question then religiously, you're given 20,000 work permits, you have 60,000 people in the ghetto. Are you allowed to hand out the work permits? Are you allowed to compile the list for deportation? What's the difference between the two of them? And the interesting thing is that the law is very clear on this, which is if an enemy surrounds the city and asks you to give one person or they will destroy the entire city, you may not give up the one person. But if the enemy names the one person, Ploni Almoni, then you may give over the one person and save the city. What is the difference between the two of them? In one case, you are deciding who shall live and who shall die. In another case, somebody else has made that decision. But the second issue becomes, are the 20,000 work permits life-saving for 20,000 people, or are they dooming for 40,000 others? And what do you do at that point? And from my mind, what has come out in the religious discussions has been something very, very important, which is that they tell us some struggle and some sense of how to live with integrity in a situation in which it is almost impossible to live, and even more difficult to live with integrity, moral integrity or religious integrity. Let me touch on two other areas and then sum up. One of the other things that's come out recently has been a new area of work, which is called Jews Saving Jews. Yad Vashem, to its enormous credit, has taught us a lot about non-Jews who save Jews. They name them the righteous among the nations of the earth, and my criticism of that is very slight. I'm not sure how many people strive to be righteous. I think many more strive to be decent. My mother's statement, be a mensch. So I think they've made the saving too exalted. But on the other hand, they emphasized non-Jews who save Jews, but they didn't give us role models of Jews who save Jews. And now understanding how you can act to save each other in a moment of difficulty becomes a whole area of scholarship, a whole area of learning, and a whole area of modeling what people can do. It is very important for, and I've dealt with this, for example, in Cincinnati, in a museum to the Underground Railroad. It's very important to understand in the Underground Railroad the help that was offered by decent white people. It's absolutely essential to understand the courage of the black people who acted in solidarity with each other. In this history, what the Jews did and how they helped each other becomes very important. And also it becomes important to show us something else, which is that just because Jews were powerless does not mean they were passive. Let me repeat that. Just because Jews were powerless does not mean they were passive. Lastly, let's talk about one final thing. We had a mantra. You heard one part of the mantra, Zachor. And for many years, we were afraid how the Holocaust would be remembered, whether it would be remembered. Now we have to worry not whether it would be remembered, it's being remembered, but we have to guard the nature of what's happening with that memory, that it's not trivialized, vulgarized, falsified. The other slogan we had was never again. But all of us have to now grapple with the idea that the Holocaust is taught where it's not the last genocide, but it's been followed by many other genocides that have taken place. And consequently, the question is, what does never again mean? I attended a conference at Yad Vashem in which they began to say, what does never again mean? After you've gotten to the idea that Jews learned from the Holocaust that powerlessness invites victimization, so part of the story of 20th century Judaism has been the empowerment of the Jewish people. And now that you have power, what do you want to achieve? And the second is the moral imperative. If it's never again, but we have again and again and again, not the Shoah, but other forms of genocide, we have to begin to understand that the Holocaust becomes the paradigm that is instructive. It teaches us that we cannot stand idly by, and the most that we can say, never again, not with my consent, not with my silence, not with my passivity and not with my acceptance. And there's a wonderful Hasidic story with which I'll close. Rebbe once taught, sometimes you yell at the world to change the world, and sometimes you yell at the world to make sure the world doesn't change you. We have to continue yelling at this world. Yelling loud, yelling loud, yelling loud. And we have to exemplify the notion of compassion and justice. Thank you very much.